It's great to see you. Listen, it was funny. My presence here is actually kind of fluky slash providential. I have just like a week ago or whatever got back from a good extended break this summer, which was fantastic. And this weekend, we're having live preaching at all of our campuses all across Chicagoland. And there was one gap, and it was at Aurora. Nobody wanted to preach at Aurora. John said that he had done it before. He was feeling a little bit sick. He's been busy all summer. And I was like, I preach sometimes. So, like, I could go do it. And so I was really excited because I love coming down here. This my wife, you guys, I hope you have a chance to meet her afterwards. She's, thanks. She's my best friend and certainly a better human being than I am. And love her to pieces. So, I mean, we'll be out in the back there and love to say hi to you. Afterwards, like I said, always come down here. Jeannie actually has been, we've worked in churches that are just like Aurora. This has been kind of, this is what we were accustomed to until we got into where we were in Canada, and it was a big mega church and stuff. But our hearts have always been kind of for this kind of thing. And so I'm really excited about the chance that we just get to open God's word together. So like John said, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 to 17. I don't know if you've ever seen this this Bible. It's a mocking Bible, and I've mentioned before, if you've heard me preach for a long time, I've mentioned it a couple times. It's called the Awkward Moments Bible. Awkward Moments Bible is a children's Bible that is done as a satire or a mockery on Christianity. So listen, don't write it down and be like, oh, he recommended the Awkward Moments Bible. No, it's not that. What they do, though, is they try to show how all of these Bible stories like Noah's flood or David killing Goliath, how all of these stories are actually quite gruesome if you read the whole thing, and that we tend to sanitize some of that kind of thing when we read it to our kids. You know, David and Goliath, you know, David throws the stone, or, you know, the slingshot, the stones, Goliath goes down, and we say, isn't that neat? That's the end of the story. Well, actually, the end of the story is David cutting off his head. Which we don't usually tell our kids because we're like, well, we feel like we want to clean it up a little bit. But this Bible's basically saying, look how violent and horrible Christianity is. You know, who cuts off the head of the person that they're fighting against? That's like ISIS kind of stuff. In the picture of Noah's flood, so they do these cartoons, right? In the picture of Noah's flood, there's Noah on his ark with all his family, and they're all smiling, and the sun is, you know, shining on them, and they got all the animals, but in the water below them are all of the other people who've, of course, been wiped out. And they're all dead, floating in the water, and the idea is, what kind of God would do that kind of thing? Select just these people and kill everybody else. You see, the Bible is filled with horrors. The Bible is filled with stories that you probably shouldn't tell your kids without sanitizing it. And when you get older, you realize that actually the morality that the Bible is trying to espouse is not really good morality. It's trying to teach you certain ways of looking at your life and the life around you and your sexuality and power and all those things. It's trying to teach you something that's going to be bad for you. That the good, true, and beautiful life is actually held in rejection to Scripture as opposed to bowing one's knee to it. Sam Harris, who is a well-known atheist, he actually is a philosopher and a neuroscientist. He wrote a book in years ago, in the early 2000s, called The End of Faith. Here's what he said. Again, atheist, very famous atheist, very provocative, pointed atheist. He wrote actually a book at one point called The Letter to a Christian Nation, where he tries to argue that you're all, and if you believe in God, you're an idiot. Here's what he said. He said, it's time we admitted from kings and presidents on down that there is no evidence that any of our books was authored by the creator of the universe. The Bible, it seems certain, was the work of sand-strewn men and women who thought the earth was flat and for whom a wheelbarrow would have been a breathtaking example of emerging technology. To rely on such a document as the basis for our worldview, however heroic the efforts of redactors, meaning people who cut and paste it together so it makes it sound plausible, to rely on such a document as the basis for our worldview is to repudiate 2,000 years of civilizing insights that the human mind has only just begun to inscribe upon itself through secular politics and scientific culture. Guys, it's 2023. We've evolved, at least mentally and intellectually, into a world where we understand things that these stupid people who ate food mixed with their own feces don't understand. So let's just move past it. Christopher Hitchens, the late Christopher Hitchens, also one of the new atheists back in the 1990s and 2000s, he wrote his book, God is Not Great, How Religion Poisons Everything. And here's what he says about the Bible. The Bible may, indeed does, contain a warrant for trafficking in humans, ethnic cleansing, slavery, bride price, and for indiscriminate massacre. But we're not bound by any of it because it was put together by crude, uncultured human mammals. So the Bible's outdated, it's immoral, it's grotesque, and it's a ridiculous guide to ethics. So says the critic. So why should we trust the scripture? I mean, we gather every week. I usually have like this big screen and I draw on it. I try to make it a big deal. Hey, look, it's the Bible. Let's study and learn exactly what these people said. They were, you know, God speaking through them and all that. Why should we trust it? I assume that we trust it when I cut together and we preach it. So a lot of churches have abandoned it because we don't trust it. But why do we, Harvest Bible Chapel, we put it in our name? Why do we trust it? Well, look, this passage, 2 Timothy. I had you there for a second. No, in the 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 to 17 is really a place where Paul, the apostle, sort of argues why you should trust it, or what it does to us, okay? So I have three reasons why it is that we should trust the Bible. I will tell them to you now, and then we'll work through them. Number one, the Bible can be trusted because mom says so. I know that sounds weird, but he actually argues that, because mom says so. The Bible can be trusted because God says so. And then the final is that God, the Bible can be trusted because we say so. So mom says so, God says so, we say so. You'll see what I mean by each of these. Here's the first. The Bible can be trusted because mom says so. Verse 14, 2 Timothy, it's been a while. 3. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed. Who's you? Well, the book is named after him, right? You is Timothy. Who's Timothy? Well, Timothy is the pastor of the church in Ephesus. What's so important about the church in Ephesus? Like, what's the history? What's going on in Ephesus that leads Paul to instruct Timothy what he's about to instruct him? Well, look, let's go back. Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Pay careful attention to yourselves. So this is the Apostle Paul. He's standing on the dock, sailing through. The elders from the churches at Ephesus, he's called them down. He's sailing through. He's never going to see them again. He knows he's going probably to his own death because the government's after him. And the Jews have been running after him the whole time. He's like, man, this is the last time we're going to talk. And so I want you to think about what kinds of things you would say to your friends or your church if this were the last moment you had, right? Tomorrow, you're done. What do you want to say to all the people left behind? Well, here's what Paul says, standing on the dock or near the dock, to all these Ephesian elders gathered around him. Pay careful attention to yourselves, your elders, you guys, and to all the flock, in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. See, I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves, I'm sure he paused there and he stared at each one of them. From among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert. What's the last thing he says? Hey, don't mean to bum you out, but some of you are fierce wolves who are going to try to ruin the church because you didn't continue in the faithful teaching. So, I mean, I don't know who it is. John. I don't know who it is. But they're going to come. So when you get to 2 Timothy, when you 1 and 2 Timothy, what you got now is you've gone in the future, and Timothy, faithful Timothy, Paul's protege, has now been put, commissioned to be the pastor of this church where the fierce wolves were going to come. And guess what? The fierce wolves have come. From among their own number. You've got elders in the church who are saying, yeah, Timothy, you're a young man. We've been around a little bit longer. You need to understand that Paul, what he said was, that was great, but, we need to have this little twist here, or we need to actually nuance there. And so they're changing the doctrine of the church. The whole book, 1 and 2 Timothy, both of them are like, don't you let them. That's basically the way it should be titled. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, punch the heretics. And so in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 8, Paul describes these false teachers. He says, just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth. They're corrupted in mind and they're disqualified regarding the faith. And then in verse 13, while evil people, specifically these false teachers, while evil people and imposters, they're not real, will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. Like they believe what it is that they're saying, but they're deceived and they're in turn deceiving. So Timothy, back to verse 14. Sorry, PowerPoint, you're gonna have to throw this back. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14. But as for you, continue in what you have learned. Look, they're going down this particular path, but Timothy, don't go there. As for you, continue. They didn't continue. As for you, continue in what you have learned. Why? Paul, tell me why it is that I should trust you and not them. Because they sound really sensible at times, right? And sometimes, Paul, man, I don't know what to make of what you write. Why should I do that? Well, continue in what you've learned and have firmly believed, knowing, okay, here's the reason, from whom you learned it. Who did he learn it from? Well, he learned it from Paul. And he learned it from his parents, specifically his mammy and grandmammy, which I'll show you in a second. Continue what you firmly believe, knowing from whom you've learned it, and how from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. You see that from the very beginning, man. You believe these things. So your mom, she helped you out with this sort of thing. And I am helping you out. If you learned it from me. So it's really, here's really interesting. So Paul, if you read immediately preceding this verse in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14, one of the things that you would notice is here are the verses that are leading into it. Verse 10, 2 Timothy 3. You, however, Timothy, you followed my teaching. So he talked about the false teachers, and then he said, but you followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, which persecutions I endured, yet from all of them the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it. You learned it from me, Timothy. So if you're trying to figure out who to trust, Timothy, I just want you to look at what you and I have been through. I want you to look at what kinds of things I've had to deal with as a representative of the gospel of Jesus. Did I ever shrink back from the oppression? Did I ever contradict the truth? Did I ever not continue in it? Have I ever lied to you, Timothy? You know I love you, Timothy. You know what I've done for you, Timothy. You know my character, Timothy. So if you're going to listen to anybody, listen to the guy who loves you and whose character you know. Also, though, you noticed that he said you've learned it from infancy. So you also learned it from your... Now, if you go to 2 Timothy chapter 1, the first verse chapter in the entire book, he said, I'm reminded, Timothy, of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I'm sure, dwells in you as well. So from whom did he learn it? Mama. He learned it from mama and grandmama. He is the product of generational belief. Look, I'm kind of making a big deal about this, and here's why. You know, it's the time of the year where everybody goes back to college, or you're going to go back to school. And here's what happens when you go to college. You are often confronted with people who are now going to contradict everything you've been taught by your parents who love you, and you're going to be confronted with ideas that contradict the churches you attended, and the temptation that you'll have is because the person talking to you has three letters behind their name, right, that have doctorate in them, you're going to be like, this person obviously knows more and is more trustworthy than my mom and my pastor. And here's my request. It's just a request. You should be absolutely open to learning all the things. Christianity, I by no means am afraid of dealing with the challenges to Christianity, both philosophical and biological and all of that. No problem. But what you've got to do when you go and you sit in those sorts of settings, whether it's in college or in other places, is you need to at least, before you totally buy in to what they're telling you is true, which is contradictory to what it is that you've always been taught, you need to at least say, I'm going to give those who love me and have proven through their character over the ages that they're for me, I'm going to give them a right of reply. Now, I'm actually going to take what it is that this person is saying, and I'm going to bring it back to the people who have proven to me that they care about me. You might find, in fact, that the right of reply is as persuasive or more so than what the professor did. By the way, I have a doctorate too, so... Do you know what's really weird? You probably, a lot of people don't know this, but you know the name Socrates, one of the great Greek philosophers? We only know about Socrates because his disciple Plato wrote about him. Socrates never wrote anything down at all, which is kind of weird for a philosopher. You'd think, like, if I'm going to be a philosopher and I've got important things to say or think, I should probably write them down. Like, you should be the one writing the book. Socrates never wrote anything down that he was going to teach people. He was philosophically opposed to it. You know why? He believed that when someone speaks to you face to face, you can determine their character because by the fact that you're face to face, you probably know them, or at least have access to knowing them beyond just the words they speak. And when you're trying to determine who to trust in the world, you need to be able to determine the character of the person who's speaking to you. And he was freaked out because he was like, listen, if I write it down and then you take it and you pass it off to your friend doesn't know me. It's just written down. And they're going to take that and they're going to believe it, but they don't know from whom it came. So he would never write anything down. I just want you to think about that idea, that the communication that is given by people should be evaluated based upon the character of the one who gives it. And the next time you go to Twitter, you should realize, I don't know any of these people. I just want you to think, if you did know them, right, and there's some dude in his basement, you know, going for it. He hasn't been employed for 4 years because nobody can get along with him. And he's like, and he tweets everything all the time. Or some person who's like got, they're just full-blown atheist and they've never even heard arguments for the existence of God, or they just don't want there to be a God. And they're in there, and they're, you know, living the most disrespectful and degenerate life. And you and I, we don't know the difference between that person and Mother Teresa when they're typing this stuff. So look, we live in a world where it's really hard to figure out who to believe. And all I'm saying is believe the people who love you and have demonstrated their character to you. So, Bible can be trusted because mom told you so. Second, the Bible can be trusted because God says so. Do you know what's really great about this? When I come to the campuses, they never put up a clock to tell me how long I am, so I don't even care. Like, honestly, it's like, whatever, we'll leave eventually, and some of you are scared half to death now. Don't worry, it'll end at some point, but not yet. Okay, so the second, the Bible can be trusted because God says so, right? I need you to put your thinking caps on for just a second. I'm going to talk a little bit of philosophy here for a second. I want you to read verse 16. So Paul moves from the effect the scriptures have had on Timothy's life. They've made him wise for salvation, and his mom and his grandmother have been teaching them his whole life, and Paul has been instructing him, stick with it, Timothy. Continue in them. You know who we are. You should continue. And then he talks more broadly about scripture. The Bible. Let me tell you, says Paul to Timothy, what the Bible is. All scripture, he says, or probably better translated, every scripture, meaning every individual passage of scripture, not all as a whole, but every single itty-bitty one, is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. So at the beginning, all scripture, what are we talking about? So then in Greek, this is the Greek word called graphē. In this time period in the Bible's history, that term, graphē, had taken on a very specialized meaning. It meant the holy scriptures. It meant to them, it's not just writings in general, it's writings of a spiritual nature given by God that we believe. Okay, so you can substitute Bible there. Every scripture. Now, you got to think, okay, Paul is writing at this point probably in the 60s, AD 60s, right? He doesn't have a completed Bible, right? So he must primarily be talking about the Hebrew scriptures, or what we call the Old Testament. Because that's what he's referring to. And that's the scriptures that Timothy was brought up on. So every scripture, and by that he means the Hebrew scriptures, is God-breathed. And you're thinking to yourself, ooh, then what about the New Testament? Because that's what we're reading right now. What about the New Testament? Is that God-breathed? And I'm going to try to argue that yes, and I'll show you why. So in 1 Timothy chapter 5, just listen to this text, and I want you to hear where the word scripture shows up. 1 Timothy chapter 5, the pastor's life verse, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor. No? I put that on my mirror. The double honor. So take whatever honor that you were going to give somebody else, double it, and then to me. Yes, Sharda? All right, buddy. Especially those who labor in preaching and teaching, Sharda. Right? Double. Whatever you get, single. Double. I'm kidding, by the way. Somebody's going to record that. Did you believe that this pastor of Harvest? Sorry. Anyway, okay. For the scripture, so why should you do that? For the scripture, there it is, graphe, says, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain. Now, that's a quote from Deuteronomy 25, verse 4. We would expect that. Scripture says, in the Hebrew scriptures in Deuteronomy 25, 4, that. Yes, scripture. And scripture says, the laborer deserves his wages. Where's that from? Luke 10, verse 7. Well, wait a minute. So Paul just said that what we call scripture, this specialized word for Deuteronomy 25, God breathed, is also Luke 10? Yeah. So Paul must have understood that the Gospels were graphe. And because they were graphe, and he's writing about graphe, they must have the same authority and trustworthiness and everything else that the graphe of the Old Testament has, it also has in these Gospels. Do you follow that? All right, here. One more. 2 Peter 3, verse 15. Count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you according to the wisdom given him. I love this statement about what Paul, about reading the Apostle Paul. Here you go. As he does in all his letters when he speaks of them in these matters. Look, there's some things in them that are hard to understand. And God's people said, amen. Which ignorant and unstable, they twist to their own destruction. Yeah, like the false teachers in Ephesus. Some of what Paul writes, they're like, we're going to twist it and tweak it. They twist it to their own destruction as they do the, what? The other graphe. Wait a minute. So there's other graphe. There's other scriptures. There's that word. And Paul's is with them. They twist Paul's graphe just like they twist the other graphe. Okay, so now we've got Peter testifying that he understands Paul's letters to be on the same authoritative God-breathedness as Luke, the Gospels, and as the Old Testament. Put all of that together, and what you've got is all scripture is breathed out by God. Every scripture, Old Testament, New Testament, is breathed out by God. What does that mean? Every word I'm speaking right now is breathed out by Jeff. Hey! Jeff breathed. Jeff breathed the hay. You can understand the picture, right? I'm sure it is possible to breathe while breathing in. When I was a kid, we did that. But that's not the normal way that you speak to people. You speak, every time you speak, you breathe out. Every time. So what Paul is saying is that every graphe, every scripture, every written word from God is
literally God's very words. It's what God is saying.
That's crazy, because you know what? It's also what Paul was saying, or what Luke was saying, or what the writer, you know, Moses was saying when he wrote Deuteronomy. So think that through for just a second. What you've got in the Bible is you've got letters, documents written by human authors who are using their own, like, nuances and stuff. A letter that I write is going to be different than the letter that my wife writes. When I text you, it's going to sound mean. When she texts you, it's going to sound nice. God is taking the unique character of each author and how they write, and he is superintending using that uniqueness and saying, those are my words. Are they the human words? Yes, 100%. Are they God's word? Yes, 100%. So that whatever it is that you read in the Bible, yes, is written by mammals, as Hitchens said, but it's also superintended, breathed out words from God, God's very words. This is a huge issue then. If whenever you take up the scriptures, you are reading the very word of God, that means a couple of really, really big things. One, it's as true as God is. And two, it's as authoritative as God is. It's as true as God. Have you ever come across somebody and they'll say, maybe you yourself might say, you know what, I hear what it is that the Bible is saying. I just don't think it's true. So here's what they're saying. If it's God's very words, which I just established, if it's God's very words, what they're saying is, yes, I've heard God's very words, and I think he's kind of dumb. The right response to this is, who do you think you are to speak back to God? Like, dude, I followed you for a little while, and you can't even drive right. You make mistakes in simple addition. And you're standing over in a truth sense saying, well, actually, my truth transcends God's truth. What are you talking about? There are Christians who walk around and say, you know what, I know the Bible talks about hell, and I wish it didn't, but it does, so I have to tell you about it. Whoa, 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 Pastor, hold on. You wish it didn't? What, you're like more compassionate than God? God's very words, Jesus didn't seem to have any trouble talking about this subject or poking people in the ribs about their money. And you're like standing up and going, hi, church, I just really wish you'd like me more, so I'm going to. And don't we all know that our modern culture has much better ideas about money or about whatever than the Bible does. And so we're going to go with that. Or even if we aren't going to go with that, we're going to go for the Bible. We're going to do it in an apologetic fashion. Who do you think you are? You think that you have a truth that transcends God's truth? What are you talking about? Okay, hold on, Jeff. Objection! Julie, time out, right? That's your, Julie Untied works with me. This is her thing. Time out, like she's the referee. I always want to go, I have an objection. You cannot use the Bible to claim the truth of the Bible. That's circular, right? You cannot use the Bible to claim the truth of the Bible, and Jeff, you just used the Bible to claim the truth of the Bible, so it doesn't count. To which I'm going to say every ultimate truth claim is guilty of that. Listen,
all ultimate truth claims are circular. There's no higher truth to appeal to than the truth. Do you understand? When you're a parent and your child is like, well, I don't want to do that. You know, clean your room. I don't want to do that. Why should I do that? Your response? Because I said so. Because I said so. To whom did you appeal? The answer is, you appeal to yourself. Why did you appeal to yourself? Your kid could be like, well, that's circular. Right? I mean, you can't appeal to yourself as an ultimate authority because you can't. And yes, you can. You know why? Because in your mind, you are the ultimate authority. Over you, son, I am the ultimate. Who are you going to go? You're going to go to a judge somewhere? There is no judge. I'm the judge. So who are we going to appeal to? If we want to say, well, look, that's circular reasoning. You have to use something else to prove the truthfulness of the Bible. No, I don't. If the Bible is the ultimate truth, it's the only thing that can prove the ultimate truth of the Bible. Because if I appeal to something else, doesn't that become a truth above the Bible? All right, let me try to bring that back. So my point is that the Bible is as true as God is. If you want to know what's true, good, and beautiful in the world, take up and read. If you want to define your life by anything that's true in a world that doesn't say, oh, well, we don't know what's true, yes, we do. God said so. Second, though, it's also as authoritative. It's also as authoritative as God is, if it's God's very words. Sometimes people after sermons that I preach will get in touch with me and they'll say something like, I didn't agree with what you said in the sermon, and which is a great, okay. But here's the way I respond. In what way did I misinterpret the text? See, I'm not really that interested in why you disagree unless you can show me where I misinterpreted the text. Now, if you can show me that, look, you got it wrong because this is the way you should properly interpret that passage of Scripture. But if you say, well, I don't know anything about that, I just didn't like how you said that or what it is that you said, my response is going to be, look, I'm guilty sometimes of saying things in ways that are not as faithful as the Scriptures are, but the guts of what I was saying, if you can look beyond the dressing, the guts of what I was saying, God's very words. Yeah, but they're breathed out by Jeff. Yeah, right? But if I'm right, if I'm echoing what the Scriptures are teaching, your fight's not with me, man. You have a choice of whether or not you want to sit in authority above the Word or under the Word of God. And I'm telling you that if it is God's very words, there's only one place that you can be to be in line with reality. You can lie to yourself and say, no, I have higher authority. But just think that through for a minute. What are you talking about? If it's the standard of truth and standard of authority, then the only place to be is under it. Some Christians will come and say, well, I appreciated what you said about the Bible, but I'm going to go home and I'm going to pray about it so I can hear from God. And I want to say, whoa, I appreciate you wanting to pray to God, but I'm telling you that only graphe has the mark of God-breathedness. And only graphe, only the Scriptures are breathed out by God and therefore are authoritative like God is authoritative. You can go home and eat a burrito and feel in the evening like you're like, whoa, God just told me I should eat more. You can do whatever you want. You can go home and feel like, well, I didn't like what he said and I prayed about it and God told me. No, if I interpreted the text properly and I told you what it says, God said it. And Jesus, actually, there's a point in the book of Mark where actually Mark is kind of telling story after story after story. One of the stories is Jesus standing up and calming the waves on the sea, right? Disciples all freaking out. He's asleep in the boat. Jesus, don't you care if we die? He stands up and says, peace be still. It all goes still. And they say to him, who then is this? That even the winds and waves obey him. The next story is a story about how Jesus comes and he casts out a demon out of us, and the demons end up saying to him, "We know who you are." And he casts them out and they do exactly what he says. Sickness is the next story. Jesus, he comes in and he heals a sick person, and the sickness immediately leaves at his word. Listen, the wind and the waves obey his word. The principalities and powers obey his word. The sicknesses in the world obey his word. What should you do then? The Bible can be trusted because God says so. All right, last one. Praise God. Last one. The Bible can be trusted because we say so. Look at verse 16. So I'll read it again. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Do you see those words there? It's profitable. It's useful for what? Well, it's useful for teaching, giving somebody instruction in something that they don't already know. Reproof, meaning poking them in the ribs when they don't live in line with what you just taught them. For correction, meaning you come along and you say, listen, you're not doing it. So you need to go this way instead of that way. And then training, it's a word actually that's used for how we train our kids. The Bible is useful for some really difficult things, in other words. Notice it's not like the Bible's useful to affirm your heart. The Bible's useful to make you feel good. I used to teach water skiing to kids when I worked at a Christian camp. Get in the water with them. You sit behind them. You pull their knees to their chest, you know, the two skis. And you used to hit it. And you tell them, don't pull your arms in like this. Go, are you going to go backwards? Just keep your hands out there. I'll hold on to you until you're up. And they would get going, and they'd get going, and you teach them all the stuff, and then they'd get up, and you're like, yay, that's fantastic. And immediately some of them are like, bleh! Then they eat it. So I got to swim. And I come to them, all right? So now here's the thing. I've taught them how to do it. And now there are times they're like, I can't do it. Yes, you can. Reproof. Well, how do I do it? Okay, I'm going to, again, knees up to your chest, correction. This is going to take too long. Training, guys, come on. We're going to keep doing this till you get it. Right. The kids sometimes cry. I'm sure there's a way to do it that doesn't involve crying, but they get frustrated. They're not sure what to do with it sometimes. If you interviewed them at the moment, you would be like, well, they'd be like, I don't like this at all. Right. The scriptures do all of those sorts of things. And there are sometimes you're going to walk out of church because you've heard the very word of God, and you're not going to feel so hot about it. You're going to be like, wow, that was, And sometimes you're going to be sitting there and it'd be like, did somebody tell this guy about my life before I got here? I've gotten emails from people before saying, how dare you publicly talk about my life? My response, who are you? Right, that's why you should come to church, is so that you can hear the Bible and it will be profitable, useful for teaching you and reproving you and correcting you and training you over the long term for righteousness. Well, what do we mean by righteousness? Well, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work, fully equipped, fully capable, tooled out to be able to address all the situations that you have in your life. The Bible will train you to be that person. I had a friend years ago who invited me to come and help with a Habitat for Humanity project in New Zealand. He said, oh, bring your tools. Guys, if you come to my house right now and you look for the tools, they're in a bag somewhere, and you're like, do you organize these? They are organized. They're all in the bag. Do you have a hammer? I don't know. I don't know. I did know then. I did have one. You know where I got it from? I got it from my son's little toy, little hammer. You know, you get him the little thing. It's the only hammer we had, so I put it in the toolbox. He's like, bring a hammer. Okay. So I brought the little hammer. It's tiny. And I showed up with my hammer. And he said to me, "What in the world? What are you doing?" He's got a nail gun with him. And he's like, "This is no good. The house needs to be completed. You've been working at it for a long time. You'll probably get a little bit done. You'll probably feel okay about it, but you are not equipped to do this task. If you sever yourself from the scriptures, if you decide, look, the Bible's so boring and I'm not going to go to a church that teaches them, I'd much rather feel happy when I leave. Like, if you're going to do that, I'm just going to tell you, you're just going to settle for your little hammer. I'm not saying you can't hammer. I'm not saying that, you're not in some way useful to God. It's just honestly completely anemic. You need a nail gun. What's going to give you a nail gun? Romans will give you a nail gun. Be fully equipped for every good work. You know, I'll just finish with this. There's this little passage at the beginning of Romans 1. You've heard it before. The wrath of God is being revealed against all unrighteousness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth in their unrighteousness. When you get through, Paul's describing what people are like apart from Christ. And he gets to a point where he says, God gives them up. His wrath is shown in God giving them up to a debased mind. To a debased mind. A mind turned in on itself. So the problem with people who don't know Christ is they are prisoners to a debased mind. You go to Romans chapter 12, okay? So he describes from Romans 1 to Romans 11 the gospel of Jesus Christ and the repentance and the faith and all that and what God's going to do through all that. Romans chapter 12, verse 1, I beseech you therefore, or I urge you therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. Verse 2, do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may test and approve what the will of God is. Okay, wait, so people who don't know Christ, their problem is they have a debased mind, and those who do know Christ, what they need is the renewal of their mind. See, the gospel gives you eyes to see what's good, true, and beautiful. And now you're ready for the persistent, over time, renewal of your mind. What's going to renew your mind, guys? You live in a world of debased mind all week. How are you going to get your mind renewed? And the answer is you're going to go and hear somebody teach the very word of God to you so that you get the renewal of mind. And it's through that you'll be fully equipped for every good work. To face all of the things that you currently face, doctrines and ideas about God that are true, good, beautiful, they're from Him telling you, this is what I'm like, this is what you're like, this is where we're headed. You have to come, you have to hear that so that you will be equipped to face the heartaches, the devastating injustices. You have categories in which to place that. You see the world through lenses formed by God and His Word. It's the only way you're going to make it. A woman named Michelle, a dear friend in our last church, Northview Community Church in Canada. She was part of a Bible study I did. She said, "I've never heard anybody go through the Bible like this. I want to learn how to do it." Said, okay, teach you how to do it. She did it. She's done it, did it for years. She started teaching it. She came to me right when we left. And she said, tears in her eyes, she said, I can't thank you enough for giving me a love for the Word of God. I was a shallow, tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine Christian. And now I am sure of where I'm headed, how to get there, and who I'm to be in the meantime. All scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable. the man or woman of God may be fully equipped for every good work. Amen? Lord, thanks for these dear folks. Thank you for my opportunity to come here, for their patience with me, to listen to me charge them over and over again. I pray, Lord, that in our hearts that we would grow a deep, deep love for your word, that we would know you through it. God, I know that in my own heart, I think I'm a pastor, and I so often forget what's true about the world, and I settle for other things that purport to be true but aren't. I turn away from your word too often and say, well, I'm going to live this other way because I think it makes sense in this moment. God, help us to surrender ourselves, lay ourselves down as living sacrifices. Renew our minds, we pray, Jesus. Make us fit for your kingdom, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.